In the last part of this herbs alliance, we have seen about the introduction, the indications, contraindications, then the various generations of the herbs alliance, and even the various designs of the herbs alliance. Now moving on towards the next part of this herbs alliance. Now what are the treatment effects? So they have sagittal and vertical effects, and in that too they have dental and skeletal effects. So starting off with the first, that is the sagittal changes. In that, skeletal changes are, they restrain the maxillary growth. Because this is a class 2, we are using this herbs appliance in a class 2 case. So it restrains the maxillary growth and decreases the SNA angle. Now what is this SNA angle? Over here, SNA angle is this angle. So if this angle, it is more. So the mean value for this angle, it is 82 degree. But if it is more than this, then it means that it is a class 2 case. So you are decreasing this SNA angle in that case. So this, like herbs appliance, it reduces this SNA angle. So this is the angle. So this is the SNA angle, and it increases the mandibular length. So it increases the mandibular length in the sagittal changes. So the evidence of the temporomandibular growth adaptation, the herbs treatment. So there are three processes which like are seen in the temporomandibular joint, because of which there is growth of the mandible, which contributes to the changes of the mandibular position. So first is the condylar remodeling. Second is the glenoid fossae remodeling. And the third is the condylar position changes within the fossa. So the following adaptation are, so first we have seen this is a condylar remodeling. So in this, there is increased proliferation of the condylar cartilage. And because of that, the mandibular position, it is changed. So it occurred primarily in the posterior and the posterior superior region of the condyle. And because of that, your mandible, it moves ahead. Then the glenoid fossa remodeling is, there is significant deposition of the new bone on the anterior surface of the post-glenoid spine, which is occurred, indicating an anterior repositioning of the glenoid fossa. So your glenoid fossa, there is like deposition of the new bone, and because of that, the glenoid fossa, it is repositioned anteriorly, and because of that, the mandible is also repositioned anteriorly. And this is the main thing that we want in the herbs appliance, that the mandible, it should be positioned anteriorly. Then third one is the changes which you have seen, the condylar position changes with the fossa. There is significant bone resorption on the posterior surface of the post glenoid spine, which was noted, and there is deposition of the bone on the glenoid fossa, and there is resorption on the posterior surface. There is deposition on the anterior, and there is resorption on the posterior surface of the post glenoid spine. Now what are the dental changes? So the dental changes which are seen during the herbs appliance treatment, they are basically a result of the anchorage rods in the two dental arches. So this telescopic mechanism, it leads to the mandibular anterior positioning. So in this, now you can see a posterior directed force on the upper teeth, and there is an anterior directed force on the lower teeth. So the upper teeth, they are like so they are forced to move posteriorly, and the lower teeth, that is your mandibular teeth, they are forced to move anteriorly, which is resulting in the distal tooth movement in the maxillary buccal segment, and there is mesial tooth movement in the mandible. So this is how the dental changes. So basically the dental changes are, so the first is the dental teeth, they are moved anteriorly. So there is proclination of the lower anteriors. There are mandibular incisors, they are proclined on an average of 6.6 degrees during the 6 months. So basically your mandibular teeth, they are moved anteriorly. These are the dental changes. Then the maxillary molars, they are moved distally. So this maxillary molars, they are moved distally. And the mandibular molars, they are moved mesially. So there is mesial movement of the lower molars. Then there is sagittal dental arch relationship is, the overjet, it is reduced in all the patients during the treatment by the increase in the mandibular length. Now we have seen there is this increase in the mandibular length. Because of that, the overjet, it is reduced, which was like in the class 2 patient, you will see the overjet, it is excessive. So it is reduced. Then the mandible, it increases in the length. Then the arch perimeter, so because of the distalization forces of the telescopic mechanism of the herbs appliance on the upper first molars and the anterior directed forces on the lower front teeth, the maxillary and the mandibular arch perimeter, they increases. So this is the perimeter. So this is the arch perimeter. Over here, this is the arch length, and this is the arch width. When you're drawing the horizontal line, so this is the arch width. Now in this, the arch perimeter, it increases because of the anterior displacement of the lower teeth, and the posterior displacement of the upper teeth. Because of that, the arch perimeter, it increases, but this is temporary in nature. The next dental change is the arch width. So during the treatment, the maxillary and the mandibular dental arch, they expand laterally in both the canine and the molar region. So the expansion, it is more marked in the maxilla than in mandible. So the width of the arch, it is like expanded in both the region, that is canine and the molar region. And these are the sagittal changes. What are the vertical changes? So in dental, now you'll see in class 2 malocclusion with deep bites, overbite, it may be reduced. So in this case, if there are deep bites or overbite which are present, so in that they are reduced significantly by this herbs therapy. Then an average of 3 mm, that is for 55% during 6 months of treatment, it is seen. So now we have seen this herbs appliance, it is usually used for 6 to 8 months. So in this case, so if there are overbites or deep bites which are present, so in that case, almost 55% of the treatment, it is seen in the 6 months of the treatment itself. Then the overbite reduction is primarily accomplished by the intrusion of the lower incisors. So this overbite reduction, so if the teeth, they have more overbite, so this is reduced because of the intrusion. So the lower incisors, they are intruded, and there is enhanced eruption of the lower molar. So your lower molar, so the posterior, it gets over erupted. So they are getting supra erupted, and so they are getting extruded, and the incisors, they are getting intruded, and because of that, the overbite, it is reduced. So the next is the skeletal changes. So the skeletal changes is, there is increase in the lower anterior facial height. So the lower anterior facial height, it is increased due to the over eruption of the lower posterior teeth. Now you have seen the posterior teeth, they get erupted. So they get supra erupted. So because of that, the facial height, lower facial height, it is increased. Then there is increase in the gonial angle. And this may be due to the more sagittally directed growth of the condyle, or it may result from the resorptive bone changes in the gonion region. So this is the gonial angle. So this is the gonial angle. So there is this increase in this gonial. So this angle, it is increased. Because of that, the mandible, it is moved in the downward direction. So now if this angle, it is increased. So because of that, it is moved. So the mandible, it is moved as we want for the correction of the class 2 malocclusion. So these all are the treatment effects of the herbs appliance. Now what are the advantages? So it is a fixed functional appliance, and that is not removed by the patient. Now we have seen this is a fixed appliance and it cannot be removed by the patient. And because of that, the action it produces is continuous. So the action, it is continuous. And because of this, the duration of the treatment is this short. As we have seen, like the treatment, it is for 6 to 8 months. Because of this continuous action, the treatment, it is done like usually in a shorter duration. Then less patient cooperation is needed as it is a fixed appliance, and it can be used in uncooperative patients also. Then it can be used successfully in patients who are at the end of the growth phase. Now we have seen if the patient, they are at the end of the growth phase, now as the duration of this treatment is short, it can be used if the patient, they are at the end of it. Then it can be used in mouth breather. So these are the advantages. The disadvantages. Now unlike any other functional appliance, it requires patient cooperation as the initial discomfort is usually present. Now in this, at the initial stage, the patient cooperation is required because there can be discomfort at the initial stages. Then it can cause minor functional disturbances in the masticatory system, which are temporary and it will gradually disappear. So there can be like minor functional disturbances. Then there is increased risk for the development of dual bite with the dysfunction symptoms of the TMJ as a possible consequence. Then the repeated breakage and the loosening of the appliance, it can occur especially in the lower premolar area. Then there can be plaque accumulation and there can be enamel decalcification, which is specially seen in the splint type of herbs appliance. Then there is tendency for the posterior open bite at the termination of the therapy. So there can be, if now we have seen the maxilla in the treatment effect, so your incisors, they are intruded and your like posterior teeth, like your molars, they are extruded, and because of that, if the effects, they are excessive, and because of that, it can lead to posterior open bite. The anchorage system for the herbs appliance. Now we have seen that we are fixing the components of the herbs appliance onto the bands. So the anchorage that we get from this band, it should be good so that the breakage, it is avoided. So there are basically four types of anchorage system that are partial, total, then there is splint, and there is pilot. So first is the partial, which is commonly used. So conventionally in the maxillary arch, the first premolars and the permanent first molars, they are interconnected on each side with the half round or the round sectional wire. Now in this, so this first molar and the first premolar, so they are interconnected. Now you can see with the help of this wire, this both teeth, they are interconnected. And in the mandibular arch, the first premolar bands, they are connected with the round lingual wire that touches the lingual surfaces of front teeth. Now over here, now you can see, so on this first premolar, so this first premolar bands, so they're connected with this round wire, which is connected on this, so which is placed on this front teeth of the mandible. So this type of anchorage, it is known as partial anchorage. Now in some like instances, this type of anchorage, it is insufficient, and therefore they are incorporated with additional units. So this is a partial anchorage. Now this anchorage, because like this anchorage, it is not sufficient, and it can lead to like slippage, or it can lead to breakage, or like there can be problems with this type of anchorage system. So there are like additional units which are added to this anchorage. So now in the maxillary arch, labial sectional wire, it is placed in the brackets of the premolars, canine, and incisors. So now when you are placing the wire onto the brackets of premolar, canine, and incisor in the maxillary arch and in the mandibular arch, the lingual sectional wire, it is extended to the permanent first molar. Now over here in the partial one, now you have seen, you're like using, so you're connecting this wire till the first premolar. But now if this lingual wire, it is extended till the first molars, so in that case, this is known as a total anchorage. So in this, the anchorage, it is increased, so you are getting more anchorage with the help of this molars in the lower, and in the upper, in the maxillary, you are extending the wire. So you are extending the wire onto the premolar, canine, and even the incisors. So this is a total anchorage. Now in the deciduous and the mixed dentition period, the bonded type of herbs, it is used because of the absence of the first premolars. And this system, it is known as splint anchorage system. So when you are using the splint appliance or the splint anchorage system, so this is known as a splint anchorage system, and this is used in deciduous and mixed dentition because in those, like the first premolars, they are not erupted. The next is the pilot anchorage system. Now in the mandibular arch, with the lingual arch wires, acrylic pilot, it is fabricated and is fixed touching the lingual mucosa, which is about 3 mm below the gingival margin. So this is the type of pilot anchorage system. Now in this, this lingual arch wires, they also have this acrylic pilot, which is seen, which is touching all the teeth, and it is usually, so this is your gingival margin, so it is below the gingival margin, like around 3 mm below the gingival margin. So over here, now you're using this acrylic pilot and also this lingual arch. So this system, it is most efficient in withstanding the stresses which are placed on the lower anterior teeth. So over here, now you are using this acrylic pilot and also the arch wire. So this is about the fourth one, that is the pilot arch system. So these all are the four systems, anchorage system. Now what are the modifications in the herbs appliance treatment? So in class 2 cases which have a narrow constricted maxillary arch, so in that expansion, it can be performed with the herbs appliance by soldering a quad helix or other rapid palatal expansion devices to the molar and the premolar band. So if you have constricted maxillary arch and you want to expand it, so with the help of this herbs appliance, you can also use this quad helix or other rapid palatal expansion devices, and then you are like incorporating the herbs appliance with this palatal expansion devices, and with this you can also have the expansion of the maxillary arch. So this is the first modification. Next is, if the mandibular first premolars, they have not erupted, you can use permanent canines for the anchorage. So the third modification is the buccal tube, it can be welded to the mandibular molar band for the addition of the frontal type lip pads, which is useful for the correction of the hyperactive mentalis muscle activity, or a lip bumper, it may be added to the buccal tubes to provide a distalization forces to the mandibular dental arch. So this is the third modification, in which what you're doing is you're welding lip bumper in the buccal tubes, or the buccal tubes, it can be welded to a mandibular molar band for the addition of a Frankel type lip pad. So you are just like using or you are adding lip pads or the lip bumper to the Herbst appliance. If the case is, if there is a hyperactive mentalis muscle activity, in that case you are also using this lip bumper. So the third, fourth modification is, now Raymond, he suggested the use of vertical chin cap, vertical pull chin cap, or a high pull headgear in the case of patient with vertical hyperplasia of the lower face along with the Herbst appliance. So if there is vertical hyperplasia of the lower face, so in that case with the Herbst appliance, you can also use a chin cap or a headgear, that is a high pull headgear or a pull chin cap. So this is the fourth modification. Now the fifth modification is, now the Tarek, he has modified the appliance to decrease the breakage problem with a banded Herbst appliance. So there is a problem with the banded Herbst appliance that it gets breaked off. So it is called as, the modification is called as MDEN modification. Now what it includes is, it includes a stainless steel crown on the maxillary first permanent molars. So over here. So it includes this stainless steel crown on the first maxillary permanent molar, then a removal acrylic splint on the mandibular arch. Now over here, now you can see over here. So this is the acrylic splint on the mandibular arch and a stainless steel crown on the maxillary first molar. Then there is double buccal tubes on the stainless steel crowns of the first permanent molar, which can accommodate utility arches, sectional or the continuous arch or the continuous wires. So over here. So on this, so this is the fifth modification to reduce the breakage problem of the banded ones. So in this, you are incorporating a crown, a stainless steel crown on the maxillary arch and an acrylic splint on the mandibular arch. And there is this buccal tube on the both sides. So there is this buccal tube which is attached to this crown. So this is the Tarek, which is known as MDEN modification. The next is the screws. They protrude enough to encroach upon the mucosa, and because of that, the screws, they causes ulceration of the mucosa of the cheek. So to prevent that, we are using this hub caps. They are marketed which can cover the screws. So this caps, they are covering the screws, and because of that, the ulceration, it is prevented. So this is a modification. The next modification, it is the sandblasting the underside of the band or the crown with the micro etcher. It increases the retention of the appliance. Now this micro etcher, what it does is, it like provides precise surface micro roughening. So this is a micro etcher. So it provides surface roughening, and because of that, the bone strength, it is increased by the 400%, and because of this, the retention of the appliance, it is increased. Now the next modification is flip-lock Herbst appliance. So the flip-lock Herbst appliance, so over here, this is a flip-lock Herbst appliance. So it is a new design, and it reduces the number of the moving part that can lead to breakage or failure. And it is easy to use, and it is more comfortable for the patient than the conventional Herbst appliance. Over here, instead of a screw, it has a ball joint connector. So instead of screw, over here, now you can see this is a ball joint connector, and this is a flip-lock Herbst appliance. Now flip-lock Herbst appliance, it has three generations. So the first generation is when you have this appliance which is made up of plastic. Then the next, but over here in the first generation, the problem is, now it is made up of plastic. So when the stresses, they are applied on the appliance, so there are the chances of breakage. So to overcome that, the appliance, it is made up of metal in the second generation. So in second generation, the plastic, it was replaced with the metal. Now the third generation, it is made up of a horseshoe ball joint. So over here, this is made up of a horseshoe ball joint. So this system, it has provided to be more efficient than the previous first and second generation. And in the terms of both, like the application as well as the resistance to the fracture. So the third generation is the horseshoe ball joint. Second is made up of metal, and first was made up of plastic. So this is about the flip-lock Herbst appliance, which is used to prevent the breakage. And the last modification is the Herbst with a mandibular advancement locking device, and which is known as MALU. So over here, this is the MALU, that is the Herbst with a mandibular advancement locking device. So in this, the upper arch of the edgewise Herbst appliance, it has only the molars which are banded with the head gear tube. So over here, these are low. So in this MALU appliance, so the upper molar, so only the upper molars, they are banded with this head gear tube. And if there is over expansion, so in that case, you can use a palatal arch. Now in the lower arch, So the first molar, they are banded. So in this, the first molars, they are banded, and the anterior segment, it is bonded from the cuspid to the cuspid with the help of brackets. So in this, the molar, it is banded, and the anterior teeth, they are bonded with the brackets. And in this, the bicuspids, they may be left unbracketed to help in the settling the occlusion and the locking of the device. So this is about the malu. And because of this, there is advancement in the mandibular arch. And this is all we want for the Herbst appliances, that it should treat the class 2 malocclusion where there is mandibular, where there is retrognathic mandible, and we want the advancement of the mandible. So these were all the modifications of the Herbst appliance. This was all about the Herbst appliance. I hope you found this video helpful. Thank you so much.